Please welcome the Vice President of Strategy and Long-Term Development at Thrivent Financial, Mr. Bill McInerny.
Good morning, everyone. It's exciting for me to be up here, and I'll send the greetings from our CEO, who was sorry he couldn't be here to do this himself. Thrivent really began its D&I journey about 5 years ago, and as part of my role in as executive sponsor for the work, one of the first things that I did was come to this forum. And I learned a ton, I met a lot of great people, and this really was, I think of it as sort of a starting point for us. 2 years ago, many of you were probably here when our CEO spoke, and Brad Hewitt from this stage, and talked about his commitment to building an excellent company, and the fact that you can't be an excellent company without diversity and inclusion. That later that same day, I had the good fortune to make an offer to Leslie Taylor, who became Thrivent's very first full-time leader of diversity and inclusion. And today I got to start in my morning at 7 o'clock with a group of business leaders and D&I professionals from the Twin Cities who are committed to progress here in this region. So it really has become sort of an important time in the year for me to come back, see old friends, meet new folks, learn new things, and help think about how are we going to carry this ball forward in my company, in my personal life, and in this region. Many of you may not know, I think of Minnesota, it's the land of 10,000 lakes, but when it comes to diversity and inclusion, it's also a land of 10,000 contradictions. This year Minnesota elected the first ever Somali American to our legislature. She's a Muslim woman. Yet, out of 17 Fortune 500 companies in the Twin Cities, we don't have a single one with a woman CEO. We're one of the top regions in the country at attracting professionals of color, but we're the worst when it comes to retaining them. We're also the first state to hire a full-time chief inclusion officer for our state, but as a region, we have some of the worst disparities on race between whites, blacks, and Hispanics on incomes, employment, health, and many other important factors. So we're a region with a great heart and a lot of great intention, and we're working really hard to turn that into results. And it's fun for me to be part of that, it's exciting, and it's really important work. So we're delighted to sponsor and we're delighted to be part of this morning's session. I'm delighted to introduce Subha Barry, who is a passionate advocate for leading with your heart, but also getting results. Subha is Vice President and General Manager of Working Mother Media, overseeing Working Mother Magazine, WorkingMother.com, Diversity Best Practices, and the National Association for Female Executives. She was born in India and lived there till she was 21, came to the US to earn her MBA and a master's in accounting at Rice, and then went on to a successful career in financial services. The lack of diversity in that industry, combined with the absence of multicultural role models, was a huge catalyst for the direction of Subha's career, from frontline business, operational, and leadership roles to becoming a change agent focused on creating inclusive work environments. Her unique value proposition has been to show the connection between bottom-line results driven by innovation that comes from an inclusive culture and diverse workforce. Please join me in welcoming Subha Barry.
Well, good morning. It is such an honor and privilege to be here with all of you today. And I am thrilled that after giving a few remarks that I'm going to be moderating and leading a very, very interesting panel of speakers. A special shout out and thanks to Steve, Heidi, and team. This is my second time at the forum, and I know I'll be back. So it's been an interesting few months post the election and the inauguration of President Trump, eh? Right? The continuing divisiveness, acrimony, and just the inability to be civil, whether it's, you know, how we relate to colleagues in the workplace who may not think the same way we do, or members of our community, and especially on social media. It's really been difficult for all of us. We're seeing our country change, and we're seeing our country divided across issues of race relations, women's rights, immigration rules, and even things like transgender bathroom rights. I mean, where are we headed? And these implications in our workplace have impacted how each one of us walks in the door every day. It used to be an environment where we used to check in our home life at the door and step into work and check out our work life at the door when we went home, and now that's history. We don't do that anymore. Not only have our work and our personal lives melded and blended together, we are bringing our value systems, our religious beliefs, our cultural norms into the workplace, and we are demanding that our employers reflect that, align with that, speak out about it. And it has never been more evident than the aftermath of this election. So what responsibilities do each one of us have as employers, as employees, as members of our community, and even within our families in terms of how we teach our children and young ones to relate to each other in the communities? Part of our mission at Working Mother Media and Diversity Best Practices is to really call attention to companies and organizations that have been unwavering in their support, not just of diversity and inclusion, but in terms of its implications for all of their employees. And during these turbulent times, that has become a hallmark of companies that are doing well versus those companies that have chosen to remain silent on the issues. I want to share with you some findings from our newest insight paper. It is titled Bold and Inclusive Leadership. And what we did in that insight paper was we looked at what leadership traits the companies that are actually outspoken and more open about it display versus those that do not. And we realized that elements of these leadership traits should not just exist with the CEO and the C-suite, but really should cascade down to all levels in the organization. A company that allows people to step up and feel like they have a voice in how their company culture grows and changes is the company that is going to survive and thrive. This paper highlights three fundamental building blocks of what we're calling bold and inclusive leadership. So the first block is really about how these leaders are making a deep and personal commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion. They're willing to take risks in order to stay true to that commitment. And the example I'll use for that is the CEO of AT&T. Randall Stephenson delivered a powerful speech encouraging AT&T employees to have candid, open dialogue and conversations. And this was at a time when we were dealing with the Black Lives Matter movement. And remember, people are talking about Black Lives Matter, Police Lives Matter. He actually took a stand and spoke out about it. He said, to quote him, "Our communities are being destroyed by racial tension. We are too polite to talk about it." And he ended by saying, "Tolerance is for cowards." Think about it, tolerance is for cowards. Being tolerant requires nothing more than to be quiet and not make any waves. And he encouraged AT&T employees to not be that and do that. They walked their talk by aligning their external messaging with internal communication. That's the second quality. And I want to cite a gap that we found in our 2016 benchmarking report that we did at Diversity Best Practices. Companies that had CEOs that were putting external messaging about their D&I commitment, 88% of those surveyed we're making those sort of bold external commitments. And guess what? You juxtaposition that against 24% of the organization that had diversity objectives for their executives. 39% required their direct reports to report on it on a regular basis. And only 30% of them tied compensation to their diversity performance. So think about the gap, 88 versus the rest of the numbers. So I guess there's precious little walking the talk happening. The third one is that they hold themselves and their teams accountable for gathering the metrics, executing the diversity and inclusion programs, and the best practices within the organization. And what does that mean? It means that they keep track of what is actually happening. A great example of this is Intel. It set a goal to reach full representation of women and underrepresented minorities in the US by the year 2020. They committed $300 million to accelerate that, putting their money where their mouth was. And not only did they do that just within Intel, they did it across the technology industry. They hold every one of their 107,000 employees accountable for this by tying it into a company-wide bonus pool and bonus system that rewards employees for behaving in the right kind of manner. And that's what changes culture. I want to give a shout out to the Intel leadership team, but especially their ex-chief diversity officer, Roslyn Hudnell, who now leads their foundation. Leadership matters, but so do important demographic and social trends. And in our 2016 Insight paper that was titled Workforce 2025, we called out some important trends to the attention of all of our member companies and others. I want to share just two things from there with you. Finding one, over the next 5 to 15 years, we're going to have an unprecedented number of corporate leaders who are going to retire. 10,000 baby boomers are turning 65 every single day for the next 15 years. So think about the opportunity that presents for each of your companies. It gives us an opportunity to advance talent, diverse talent, in those same unprecedented numbers. D&I champions must ensure that they are removing both unconscious and conscious bias out of their talent processes. How you recruit, how you develop people, how you promote people, remove the bias from the system so that we can have a battle-ready bench of candidates to take over the CEO and C-suite roles that are diverse, that are from underrepresented minority groups. I think that our ability to remove bias from these systems can absolutely make all the difference. The finding two was about the generation of young people that we call millennials. They are coming into the workplace with this profound sense of fairness and justice, wanting to do the right thing. And they are creating the biggest social justice movement since the civil rights movement in the 1960s. Whether it's Occupy Wall Street, or Black Lives Matter, or even take the Women's March. They make up 44% of our population, but 75% of the global workforce. And we have a unique opportunity as employers and as colleagues to harness their thinking. And we are so excited to be able to welcome them into the workforce. Think about what could come if we charge them with finding solutions for some of the persistent problems that we have been facing. So in order to do that, what do you need to do? You need to create a critical mass of representation from all different communities so that you can hear their voice, whether it is from the millennial group, whether it is from a community of women, whether it's based on their race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, or their abilities and disabilities. I want to leave you with an example, a very clear visual of how this plays out. Take this year's Oscars as an example. There were 4 movies out of the 9 that were nominated for Best Picture that reflected the African-American experience in our country. You remember those movies? Loving, Hidden Figures, Fences, and Moonlight, right? I saw all four of them. I know many of you did. Had there been just one or two, what do you think the odds would be of having one of those movies win the Oscar? The chances would have been diminished. But when there was a critical mass, 4 out of 9, Moonlight won, and deservedly so. But if it had Moonlight had been 1 out of 9, do you think that the odds would have been diminished? And I'm making the case for critical mass. So now that we've teed up the research, I'm really excited for you to hear from our panel today. Each one of these organizations that I'm going to invite onto the podium have exhibited bold and inclusive leadership in ways that are very unique and defining. And I'm going to call our panelists, and they're going to walk and take their seats. From the state of Minnesota, we have James Burroughs. From Clockwork, we have Nancy Lyons and Meghan McInerny. From U.S. Bank, we have Jennie Carlson and Greg Cunningham. From Unilever, we have Mita, Mallick, and Mike Clementi. Thank you. And now for a very, very special treat and a speaker, your governor, the governor of the state of Minnesota, Governor Mark Dayton.
Thank you very much. Got these fancy teleprompters here. I do it the old-fashioned way. I write it and type it myself. So when I stumble, you'll know that's the reason why. But I want to thank you for giving me the honor to participate in this really tremendous event. According to MinnPost, we are now attending, all of us here today, the biggest event of this kind in the country, with an estimated 1,300 participants, representing 300 organizations from 40 states and over a dozen countries. That's really incredible. This forum's come a long way from its first gathering in 1988, when reportedly the Minneapolis Community and Technical College hosted a two-hour video conference for local workforce leaders. Great credit is due to the University of St. Thomas, and especially to the forum's executive director, Steve Humberhaus, who has led this conference for the past 15 years, and to Steve's outstanding team. Let's give them a deserved round of applause. And of course, credit is also due to all of you. You know, any conference is only as good as its participants. You've made this a world-class event by your participation, so congratulations and thank you. You have a very impressive panel ahead of you on a very stimulating topic, bold and inclusive leadership. My definition of bold leadership was enshrined when I attended my first National Governors Association conference in Washington in February 2011. On the last morning, governors are invited to meet with the president and vice president in the East Room of the White House. President Obama took the podium and stood directly under a large portrait of President Abraham Lincoln. I felt shivers running up and down my spine as I thought, here's an historic leader standing in front of another historic leader who gave his life 146 years ago to help advance the cause of inclusion at the highest level of our government. That's my measure for bold leadership, to which I don't even come close. And when it comes to advancing diversity in state government, I don't view our initiatives as bold. I consider them long overdue. I was born 70 years ago in a Minnesota which looked very different back then. Back then, diversity training was teaching the Germans to get along with the Scandinavians, or the Norwegians with the Swedes. Now our state looks like the world, and we're much better for it. But it also means that we face the same challenges as the rest of our country and world to advance human understanding, compassion, and acceptance, especially among people who are in some way different from one another. Different races, different religions, different sexual orientations, different political ideologies. Here in Minnesota, we had a lot of catching up to do, and much more remains. But we have outstanding leaders like James Burroughs, our state's first chief inclusion officer, to increase our efforts, to expand our outreach, and to hold us accountable for our results. My father used to say, "You get what you inspect, not what you expect." Someone else said, "What you measure improves." We've made inclusion a top priority for our agency heads, for their senior managers, and I hope for everyone in their organizations. In 6 years, we've made important progress. The percentage of the state of Minnesota's workforce who are people with disabilities has almost doubled from 3.2% to 6.2%. When I took office in 2011, only 8% of state government employees were women and men of color. Now they comprise 11%, which is progress, but still far short of our goal to have the Minnesotans in state government look like the Minnesotans outside of state government, or close to 20% when I leave office in 2 years. Since 2015, however, over 20% of our executive hires have been outstanding men and women of color. Now, I believe that facts like these are important because, again, what you measure improves. However, I always feel some reservation in reciting them. People with disabilities or people from racial minorities are not statistics. They're not percentages. They're each real human beings with their special skills, talents, and life experiences that contribute to the betterment of our state. They just need the opportunities to do so. And that's our responsibility, to provide more of those opportunities. Which is why I look forward to the day, and I believe we're inching toward it, when our kind of leadership, important as it is, will not be seen as bold, but rather as commonplace. When we won't need the inclusion initiatives because there will be no one left to include. We won't have completed our work this year or next year, and it will probably take too long. But may the day come when another group of leaders will look at portraits of you and say, "Thank you for showing us the path, and thank you for leading the way." Have a great conference today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you, Governor. As I mentioned, each of the organizations that are represented on this panel have exhibited in their own way bold and inclusive leadership. And I want to start off with giving each one of them a little opportunity to tell their story. But we're going to frame it in a way that brings out some of the unique things they're doing within their organization. So we're going to start off with James Burroughs from the state of Minnesota. As the first, and I think the only, chief inclusion officer of any state in the union, the fact that your position exists is itself an indication of bold and inclusive leadership. So Minnesota took the lead, and I commend Minnesota for doing so. I know that my state, whether it's New York or New Jersey, has not done that yet. They talk it, but haven't walked it. Tell us how your team has been able to influence the way business gets done in the governor's office and put diversity, inclusion, and equity in the forefront of everything you do. And I know you've just started, but I know you've really thought about it when you took this role.
Well, thank you for that question. First of all, I want to say thank you for allowing me to be on this panel. I must say this, when I first offered this job, I said no in my head. I didn't say no to anybody else. They said, "Oh, we're moving on." But I thought it was a tremendous opportunity, but I thought it was a tremendous responsibility that our communities in Minnesota are suffering because of these great disparities in economics and housing and education. But when I said to myself, you know, we have a governor who doesn't believe this is bold, it's just a common thing to do, and it's important to do it on a daily basis for all Minnesotans, I decided to take it on. How do I influence on a daily basis? I'm part of the governor's senior leadership team. There are six of us who report directly to the governor. And as part of that, I not only influence the workforce, I not only influence how we spend our money, but also, too, our policies that come out of our office. So this time, for the first time, we also had an equity lens and equity questions that each of our cabinet-level agencies put together in order to determine what legislation was going to have an impact on underserved communities. So that's an important piece, because if you're not thinking about the impact of those things, it's hard to influence and make a change. The other thing is, too, I have a boss who you just saw who lets me do what I need to do. I came to him one day and said, you know what? We don't have a lot of budget here. I want to make sure we do a partnership, and the partnership was around workforce diversity. I said, you created a goal of 20%. We're at 11%. I got 2 years. I got to hustle and get this done. And what I did was I created a partnership with Sharon Smith Akinsanya, who runs the People of Color Career Fair, and we did a bold step, and we sponsored that as one of the three sponsors, Mitco and U.S. Bank, and said, you know what? We're going to help us help ourselves by partnering with people in the community. And when we did that, we had great results. We had an amazing turnout of 1,300 people of color. We've hired, and I'm proud to say this, about 9 folks from that conference in October in leadership level roles. And we're coming back again strong in April. But my boss, our governor, said, James, just go ahead and do it. Make it happen, and then you come back and let me know what the results are, how we're measuring it. But also, more importantly, he is the catalyst for culture change. He wants to make sure all Minnesotans are successful. We have a $1.65 billion surplus. We have a top state in the country. If you look at numbers for just everybody, but for people of color, we're at the bottom, and that's not acceptable for him as a leader and any of our other leaders as well.
And I want you to note, as you hear James speak, think about how, whether you're in Minnesota or any other state, how can you take some of these ideas back to your organizations, to your state leaders, to say, here's something that we heard that's being done, and something like this in our state would be helpful to us. So this is an opportunity for you as D&I leaders and members of D&I teams to take this back to your government relations group in your organizations to tell them about this and spread the word. So my next question is really for Nancy Lyons and Meghan McInerny from Clockwork. You are a small but mighty technology company that is based here in Minneapolis. You have a leadership team that is 70% women. But when it comes to driving D&I in the tech space, it's heavy lifting, it's hard, and you are small. So tell us about your technology diversity pledge and how you're bringing other small companies in this space to come together and collaborate to hold each other accountable for diversity and inclusion in your organizations.
Sure. I've been in the tech space for 22 years. I started when I was 7. And Meghan and I have been working together for about 18 years. And in my experience, being a woman at a table full of men for 22 years gets exhausting. And that's not the only example of where diversity is lacking, but I certainly had personal experience there. I also often tell people, I've been gay my entire life, but for the first half of my career, I hid it, and I worked very hard to hide it. And I discovered for myself that when I started living my truth, that's when I realized success, and imagined that that must be true for all of us. So we decided last spring that we wanted to be the small business in Minnesota that leads the conversation around inclusion in a really active way, especially relative to technology. We are all dealing with, in the technology space, what we lovingly refer to as bro culture. It's very exclusive, it's very white male driven, and we wanted to change that. And as a women-led organization, it seemed like we could create this grassroots effort and create community around it and have conversations. So we developed the Minnesota Tech Diversity Pledge, which is at mintechdiversity.com. And we realized that it wasn't our jobs to hold other organizations to police other organizations, but we could ask them to hold themselves accountable. And we could be very clear about the criteria that we wanted to set forth, that we wanted us all to show up around. But in addition to that, what this has sort of morphed into and what we've been able to create is a community around the work. And we have now 90 companies, and we see people respond to the Tech Diversity Pledge every day. And we're hosting quarterly meetups and producing content so that these companies can send representatives, come together, and have conversations. Because in Minnesota, what we hate more than anything is being uncomfortable. And uncomfortable conversations are that much worse. So we are the shop that is hosting uncomfortable conversations. That should be a tag. Come to us when you want discomfort are us. But I think, you know, one of the things that I realized was we don't know how to do this. We don't know how to do it, and it starts with asking the tough questions. It starts with a little bit of confrontation. And so I had this vision that we would lead this conversation, and Meghan and I worked in partnership to make it a reality, and it's actually shocking how people have responded to it.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, vision plus execution piece is really important. Like, having someone who's out setting the overall vision for, in our case, this tech diversity pledge, and then somebody like me internally who's really thinking about how do we execute on this on a daily basis. And I think one of the most important parts of the tech diversity pledge has been what Nancy talked about in terms of creating a community, and a community where mostly small and medium-sized companies can have safe conversations. Some of the challenges as a small or medium-sized company with regard to diversity and inclusion often come down to cost and who's going to execute on this. Like, you know, we want everybody in the organization working on client work, so how can we set aside the time that's needed to do this work that we believe is so important? And so it's creating that safe space for people to talk about, how can I do this as a small company? If I'm maybe only hiring 2 people this year, how am I actually going to measure movement in terms of diversity and inclusion? So I think one important part of it has been us modeling the vulnerability to say, we don't know exactly how we're going to do this, but let's be in this together. Let's have conversations as companies, as these small and medium-sized companies, about what we're trying and what's working and what's not, what is working and what's not working. And let's not be afraid of the fact that we're probably gonna mess up at some point. And let's be there to kind of catch each other. The second important part of it, I think, for us has been really focusing, again, as I said, as a smaller company, I'm not going to change our numbers in the next year. Like, our statistics aren't gonna change drastically in the next year. But if we think about diversity and inclusion as a climate, that's what inclusion does. Inclusion breeds diversity. So if you think about, you know, Nancy describes this bro culture in tech. And when I think about that as a metaphor, I think the kind of person you think about in your head as a typical coder, like the guy in the hoodie with the scooter, that's a particular kind of seed that grows in a particular kind of soil under particular conditions. And there are many companies that create the conditions that that type of seed can grow. And a lot of the work that we've been doing is around how can we create a climate where many different types of seeds can grow and thrive. And if we do that, then as we are able to start changing our numbers, those seeds, each of those individual people, is going to grow and thrive. And when you look too much at diversity first, then you're starting to check boxes and fill seats in a way that's not sustainable. People don't feel welcome. They don't get that feeling when they come into the workplace that, like, these are my people. I belong here. What we all want as human beings is a sense of belonging. And inclusion is what breeds that sense of belonging that we all are seeking so much. And so I think it's really important for companies to think about what is the climate that we're creating and cultivating, because you will attract different types of seeds if people sense that that is a climate in which I can thrive. And that's actually how Nancy and I met. I was working early in my career at a climate where it was clear to me very early on that this These were not my people. It was very gray cubicle land. I was a huge weirdo. They didn't know what to do with me. And then I met her, and she was talking to me about the company that she had at the time, and I just remember this immediate gut feeling of like, I don't know what I'm doing here, but I need to work for her. And when I went into that company, there was this immediate sense of relief, and I'm sure you guys have all had that when you walk into a company and you just think, yeah, this is where I belong. And that to me is what we're trying to create with inclusion, and that then leads to diversity thriving and growing.
Thank you, Meghan. And there are a couple of points to take away from here, and that is, you know, you look at a small company like Clockwork, and then you look at large companies that have so much more in terms of resources. But the ability for a small company to innovate, to be nimble, is far greater, and there are lessons to be learned that cross over. And yes, you're not going to change on a dime because your ability to hire an enormous volume of people simply isn't there, but you innovate in other ways, and that can become examples for your larger compatriots. Thank you. Now, for Unilever, Mike and Mita, you've taken a real stand. You've drawn a line in the sand around the advancement of women at Unilever, and you've made some great progress against it. And the governor said something, and I actually looked over at you because, Mike, you say that all the time, and that is, you know, what gets measured gets done. The governor said that too. And so you've set some very ambitious D&I targets and goals. Share with us some of the work that you've done at Unilever, and share with us some of the progress as well as the opportunities and challenges that you're facing. Yeah.
Well, first, really, thank you for being here. I always say everyone has a choice on how we spend our time, and I think all of us have a good reason to be somewhere else, but we chose to be here. And really, thanks to all of you, and, you know, thanks, Subha, again. We wouldn't rather be anywhere else, so this is great.
Thank you.
Look, a couple of things. I think Mita's going to spend time on the culture piece, because I agree, it is about the environment. But I do want to spend a few moments on what we can do practically as HR professionals as in the broader sense, to drive an agenda. And what I don't know that this is the right answer, but it's definitely what we've done, and it is around measurement. We set an agenda that, as a consumer products company, one of the biggest consumer products company in the world, we're the largest manufacturer of ice cream, for example. Yeah, that's cool, right? Yeah, that's cool. That's
Oh, yeah.
Cool. Yeah, we just launched these things called slices from Ben & Jerry's. Please go buy them. You know, as that organization, you know, we do need, as the governor said very well, we need to represent and we need to have people in our organization that understand the dynamics that consumers have, what it feels and what it looks like to have different, you know, hairstyles and different, you know, implications with skin. So this is very, very important to us. So what gets measured gets done. We set a goal to be 50% gender balanced at our management ranks and above, not gender balanced at the aggregate, we've been there for a long time, but to ensure by level that this gets done. I'm really proud to say that we, in North America, across our organization, at our management level and above, we set a goal this year by the end of 17 to be gender balanced. We hit that goal last year. So we're really excited about
that. That's terrific.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, that's huge.
But, you know, just practically, and then Mita will talk about, you know, the environment that supports it, we have a diversity and inclusion board chaired by myself and our president, and we look every month at how we're doing against our agenda, our plans, our policies, our culture, and we scorecard any team that has over five people working for them. And we literally give them a scorecard every month on how they're doing. And we create a conversation, our HR team creates a conversation around how are you doing against people of color, how are you doing against women. And, you know, how do we just, you know, hear the voices and hear what the struggles are? And I think that's important. It's a journey. But by scorecarding people in a collaborative way, it's not a punitive way. It's in a way that says, here's where you are. You know our ambition. How do we move from point A to point B in a collaborative way? Here's our playbook on how we do that. We've lifted the agenda very, very fast.
That's great.
Meet a little bit on our policies
and culture.
Yeah, of course.
So as the governor said and Mike said, what gets measured gets done, but that doesn't really mean much if you don't have the culture to support the targets. It falls apart. And I think at Unilever, where we've come to is Mike and I, the board, we don't run the company, the employees do. So it's really about the voice of the employee driving the culture. So the three notable things that we've done is, first, we went to the employees and we re-energized our women's network. And we asked hundreds of women across our locations to get involved. And I think there was a sense with the opportunity that, is this a white women's network? How does a woman of color get involved? Working mothers, young, old, LGBTQ, if you're a veteran, if you're someone with a disability, what's your story in bringing us all together? I think two of the things we've done in this space is really help women figure out how to network and create more formal networks. And I know this is a big opportunity for women and people of color. We have mentoring circles, which might sound easy, but for an organization our size, to do mentoring circles for hundreds of women becomes very difficult, but it actually became very easy because senior leaders like Mike and our CEO stepped up to say, we're gonna lead these women in groups of 12 to 16 and meet with them every 6 to 8 weeks on different topics, and so that has been great. Another piece is, it's about how we work. And so Unilever's been on a journey for the last 6 to 7 years where we're agile. So, unlike today, Mike knows where I am. I'm sitting next to him on stage. But most days he doesn't know where I am, because that's okay. He knows what I've been asked to deliver. So that could be at Starbucks, or that could be from my cafeteria at work. And so we're really looking to push the boundaries in that sense and really dialing up job share, 4-day work week, and an interesting thought about geographically agnostic roles. I'll leave that with you for a moment. So could I do this job here from Minneapolis? Why do I need to be in New Jersey doing this job, right? So that's a powerful thought that we're looking at. The second thing that we're doing is really driving cultural transformation through policy change. So we're not about launching the new sexy policy that's on the market, but really asking our population. So some of the things that we've done in this space is that we're at 16 weeks maternity leave, which I'm really proud to say.
Paid maternity leave.
And people always laugh. I say the plus 3 weeks vacation. This is an important insight because I had a baby at Unilever and the policy wasn't that 2 years ago, and I was saving my vacation to extend my maternity leave. So think about that. You give a woman 16 weeks and then she has the vacation afterwards to come back and continue to use with her family. So that's really important. We also have 4 weeks parental leave for new dads and adoptive parents, plus 3 weeks. We have full coverage of IVF, okay? Egg freezing, embryo freezing, and for anyone who has gone through this process, you know how physically, emotionally, financially debilitating it can be. And where this has been game-changing for us is we actually, through what we've done as a company, we assign fertility counselors and genetic counselors to every woman so she understands what the choices are to make that an easier journey. We also have same-sex benefits. We have gender affirmation surgery. And we have dependent backup daycare, as I know many of you do, for children. And we're also looking at where we can push the boundary for elder care, as people are having aging parents and looking after them. And one of the other insights were women were emailing Mike and I saying, you know, I am now nursing and traveling, just came back to work, and I'm having to stop nursing because I don't know what to do with the milk as I travel. And so we just signed with Milk Stork last year to ship express breast milk. And so that's really from the policy piece. And then the last thought I'll leave you with on this cultural transformation is really getting men to be allies in this space. This work does not happen without men involved. And so at Unilever, we are proud to be pledging with the UN for the He for She work. And out of that actually came an idea to start a men's working group as an offshoot of the women's group. And so what I find is that it's not people like Mike I need to convince, it's the middle managers. It's men who say, well, I have a male and a woman on my team, do I have to treat them the same? I'm a millennial dad and I'm leaving at 4:45 to pick up my son and people are looking at me strange in the office. And so we've actually created a safe space for men to, and people always say, you actually, and Mike went to one of these sessions, I was not invited because I'm not a guy. But that's okay. We want men to be having these conversations and have a safe space to be educating themselves. And that's some of the work that we're really proud of that we're doing from a cultural perspective.
So I'm hoping that somebody in the audience will, when it's time for you to ask questions, and I have my handy dandy iPad here for it, will be asking the question about the cost implications of it. Because I'm sure you are thinking about that. Boy, they're providing all these things. What are the cost implications? So please do ask that question of them in the Q&A session. So now for Greg and Jennie. I know, he shakes his head. US Bank has really impressed us because they have a holistic approach. It's not just internal, but it's also external. So you don't sort of examine what you can do for your employees and within your organization, but you really look at how you fit into a greater, broader community outside of where you are. And you've supported your employees and you've supported your community through some very, very difficult times here in the Minneapolis area. And so I want you to talk a little bit about this holistic approach to diversity and inclusion and how that's helping you build a culture that encourages and supports bold leadership at all levels in your organization.
I'll start and say that Greg really brought this to us, and he came to us in marketing, and because of some of the events that have happened throughout our communities in the last year to 18 months, he really was driven to help us revitalize, change, and make our culture much more welcoming and inclusive. We have very good trust among our employees, and we need to make sure that that continues throughout the organization, and that we continue to grow that and foster that and make it a safe place for our employees to talk about what is happening outside of the office as well as what's happening inside of the office. And Greg really started this out and has taken us on a remarkable journey.
Well, first of all, you give me way too much credit. And part of what I will say about that was out of need for a personal necessity. I mean, I had spent the previous 16 years of my career as a marketing guy. I'm a reformed marketer. Shout out to my Target peeps, because I was at Target for the 16 years in marketing and came to the bank as a marketer. And as Jennie said, there were all these events happening. You know, Trayvon Martin happened, and Ferguson happened, and events in Milwaukee happened, and the Pulse nightclub shooting in Orlando happened. And I remember Jennie saying to me, you should consider a career in D&I. And like you, James, at first in my head, I was like, no, you know, I'm not a D&I guy. I don't even know how, I wouldn't even know what I would do. You know, I don't have the background. I don't have the experience. You know, I'm a marketer. I know how to create narrative. I know how to create brand. I know how to tell stories. And she said something to me, and she's like, that's exactly what we want. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We want somebody who thinks about that and can help us sort of define our voice in the D&I space. And how do we not only think about how we think about diversity, because that workplace pillar is absolutely foundational to the work that we have to do, but how do we also influence the other aspects around how we talk to customers and think about our marketing and our communication? How do we think about how we show up in community? And how we leverage our philanthropy and our supplier diversity. And so for me, you know, it was about how am I able to sort of influence, because at the end of the day, and I said this at an earlier session, at the end of the day, the community is going to look to me. You know, I'm here in Minneapolis, people know me, and if U.S. Bank isn't doing what it's supposed to do, they're going to be like, okay, Greg, you know, we know you in the job, Mr., you know, you got the new fancy job, now what are you doing? You know, and how are you helping us? And so it was sort of selfishly thinking about, here are all the levers that I need to be able to pull in order to drive us to that inclusive culture and not just thinking about diversity. And so literally 2 weeks into the job, there was an incident here where Philando Castile was shot, and then the Pulse nightclub. So I started in May of last year, and the Pulse nightclub shooting happened in June. So literally, I wasn't in the job more than 2-3 weeks. And our CEO, Richard Davis, called me and Jennie and a few other people into his office and said, you know, what should I be doing? What should we be doing as a company? You know, we have retail branches in St. Louis, Ferguson, and in Charlotte, and in Milwaukee, where all of these things are happening. And so how do we as a company show up? And what I said to Richard is, look, first of all, you know, don't say, just take a deep breath. You know, sometimes silence, you know, it's not about, you know, being silent as much as it is. Sometimes we just need to be still and we need to be quiet and let ourselves sort of breathe and understand what the best course of action was. So first of all, don't issue no press releases. Don't be Facebooking nothing. Don't tweet nothing. You know, let's just sort of pause and take care of ourselves. Like, how are we doing? How did it affect you personally? How did it affect your family potentially? How did it affect us as a U.S. bank community? And so what we decided was we needed to make sure that our leaders understood that there is a different expectation around what leadership looks like now. And so we agreed that for the next 3 months, on every one of Richard's leadership calls to the top 250 leaders in the organization, he would talk about this new expectation around leadership. And the fact that we only have 5 core values. They're really simple. And drawing strength from diversity is one of them. And so every time you put that U.S. Bank pin on, you know as a leader that there's an expectation that you will sort of become this inclusive leader. And we made sure that Richard sort of spelled out what inclusive leadership looked like. And we then decided, before we rolled out our strategy for D&I, we actually went on this listening tour. And so we were going to go visit all of our top markets around the country, meet with all the top leadership teams, so all the market leaders and their leadership teams. And we were going to share the story, not as a way of saying this is what the strategy is, but here's our point of view. But we want you to have some skin in the game. So you poke holes in it. Tell us what's wrong with it. And I'll never forget one of the really very first meetings we had. There was a gentleman in the back of the room, and he was sort of my proxy for, you know, how was I doing? How is this resonating? He was a middle-aged white man, had been with the company for, you know, 25 plus years. And by the time I was done talking, he stood up and said, "Hey, I've been here a long time, and I've always wanted to ask this question. You know, why is there no white male BRG?" And I just kind of looked at him, and everybody else in the room was like, "Oh man, like, whoa, you know, this is about to get deep." And I went over to him, and I could tell he didn't know what was about to happen. He was just kind of like backed up, like, "Whoa, like, are we about to come to blows, or what's going to happen?" And I hugged him. And he was like, "Whoa," like he just kind of went stiff, you know? And he was like, "Why are you hugging me?" I'm like, "Dude, like, because that's the environment we want. Like, my job is D&I. I need you to ask that question. And more importantly, we need to create a culture where people feel comfortable asking that question.
That's right.
That's how I know we're doing it right, yeah. Right? Because if we can't have that conversation, then we're not creating the culture. You're not, you know, it's not about passing judgment. You know, as leaders, you know, we're hardwired to get to the solution. Like that, you know, we wanna solve it. You know, Philando Castile got shot. Oh my God, like, what can we do? What program do we need to? No, like how about we just listen and hear what, you know, our teams are, what affected them about it? And how do we, depending, regardless of where you are on the spectrum of, you know, are you with the law enforcement or are you with the community? It doesn't really matter. At the end of the day, we got to come together as one U.S. bank community, right? But to acknowledge that it happened and to acknowledge that it affects our team members is sort of one aspect of what this new sense of what leadership looked like and what bold leadership looked like. Let's at least be comfortable acknowledging that you don't have the answer, and giving our leaders permission to not being able to solve it was a big part of what we did.
You know what, I think that sometimes it takes incredible courage to be vulnerable. Mm-hmm. And as a leader, whether it is an individual or a team, you feel like you need to lead with strength always. And vulnerability is often undervalued. So great point. As it relates to D&I, I think if you really started to analyze the numbers, the benefits will always outweigh the costs. But on the surface, when you first look at it, the expense is what really bounces right up in front of you. So that comes with a challenge, that when you have to either sell it, or when you as an organization have to make a decision around it, you have to decide where you invest, where you pull back. So You know, the gains are actually dovetailed with some pain in the organization, and it takes some bold leadership to go the right way. So Nancy, this question is for you. What has been the downside of being this bold, outspoken, inclusive leader? What is the downside?
I think for us, the downside is being a small organization. You know, we have a lot of clients that are large companies, and they have teams to respond to pushback from their communities and their customers. And that somehow creates a barrier for them between the tension and the people doing the work. For us, everyone is always on the front line.
Yep.
And where we've seen tension in our customer community has been when we've made bold statements. We were one of the few organizations in town after Ferguson that stood up and very publicly said Black Lives Matter. And not only did we make a statement about it, but it was a conversation that we were trying to facilitate in our social channels. And we heard from our community that that was perhaps divisive. We had a similar conversation when the transgender bathroom bills were introduced, and you know, I very vocally said that it's not up to the government to decide how we make facilities available to our communities. And we heard from our customers then too, and I think what we have to have is very transparent conversations with our team and empower them to stay true to the values. So it begins with our hiring and how we hire people and who we hire and how they show up, because every single one of those people, of the 55 humans we have on staff, has got to be a reflection of those values we all sign up for to participate in this organization and the conversations and the work we're doing. And ultimately, what feels bad makes us better. And I think that's the opportunity that we all recognize. And in being better, what we are is more laser focused on those values. And those values are everything. Every piece of work we produce, every person that walks in tells us that they feel the energy, that our energy is palpable, that these people are in it, and our values are reflected in the work, in every conversation. We mean what we say. What you see is what you get, and the truth is here. And in a technology company, quite frankly, that's a huge differentiator. You know, the truth showing up in your tech, big deal, real big deal.
You know, what's interesting about what you're saying is, in a smaller company like yours, you are only as good as your weakest link.
Absolutely.
And when that weakest link is one out of 50,000 or 100,000, that's sort of easy to hide. But when it's one of 55, it's out there exposed.
Sure. They're all our brand. They're all our story. But I'll tell you, this year, we do a lot of work with the Family Equality Council, which is a leading advocacy and policy organization for LGBTQ families. And it was great for us to step out in support of FEC, in support of our partners at Target, who I believe felt the backlash that they, I think those people felt the backlash of their experience around the bathroom conversation. And it was great to be a tiny organization who, especially a Minnesota-based organization, able to say, we're gonna stand with Target because Target stands with us. So we created a Stand With Target campaign that was really well received, and that felt good. So that's where we demonstrate the small but mighty quality.
What's interesting about what you're saying is that there are examples that you're setting for large organizations. And so, James, I'll ask you, you know, as the only state with somebody like you in its position, how are you learning from the private sector, from corporate initiatives, from small businesses like Nancy's? What are you learning, and how are you taking that into the government?
So, good question. Prior to coming to state government, I was a consultant for the last 12, 13 years in the D&I space for large corporations and medium-sized corporations. So I got a chance to dabble, tell you all what to do, and get out and see if it worked or not. And some of it worked. So what I've learned is don't come in with all the answers. I think Greg said it best. I spent the first 4 months of my job just asking questions. talking to people, talking to groups. And what I learned is a lot of people didn't feel valued and included in state employment. They said, James, I'm here, I'm LGBTQ, I'm a person with a disability, I'm a person of color, but I don't see a space for myself to develop a career pathway going forward. So what I've learned from other companies I've worked for is how do we develop a leadership development and inclusive strategy around retaining people and promoting them. So we're going to invest money this year in developing what's going to be called the Roy Wilkins Leadership Academy, where we're going to develop all of our underrepresented employees through a leadership development academy, pair them with mentors who are our cabinet level leaders, our commissioners, and external CEOs, get them the best high quality training and promote them from within. If you don't do that, you can say you're as inclusive as you want to be, but if you don't see a pathway for growth and development, what I've learned is there's nothing there for you. The other thing too is admitting where you're not doing well. We spend about $2.5 billion a year. 2 years ago, we spent $135,000 with African American owned businesses. So I'm gonna let that register. $2.5 million, $135,000. So once you acknowledge those things, what I've said is, now what are we gonna do about it? So now we're partnered with external organizations of color who run the minority chambers. We're gonna have an event 1 to 4 this afternoon that I have to get to. We're gonna look at doing more business in that particular area. What I've learned from external folks is you gotta name it, you gotta measure it, but you gotta make the culture change. And you gotta make it so that people realize you may not be punished for not doing it, but you're gonna be damn sure held accountable for not doing the work. And one of the things that the governor has done is said in his evaluation of his commissioners who report to him, diversity and inclusion and how you measure it and where you are with workforce diversity, how you're spending your money, it will be something that you're held accountable for. And if you're not doing it, we'll give you the tools and resource to do it better. But if you continue not to do it, there's some consequences and actions around that. So those are some of the things I've learned externally. And the other thing I learned externally is from folks like Greg and others, marketing, marketing, marketing. Mm-hmm. You gotta tell the story.
Yep.
There was some great work going on before the state, even before I got hired. There was a D&I council already established. Commissioners Lindsay, France, and Mossman, they were doing all this work that I just talked about. We had a large team, but nobody knew it. So when we had our first People of Color Career Fair partnership, I brought 60 people to the career fair to sit at our three-table booth. So I had 60
wow.
people. I used to do concerts and promotions, so I said, I'm gonna do guerrilla marketing. They're gonna know the state was here, and they're gonna know what we have to offer. People left there saying, man, James, I didn't know you all had these opportunities. You had this event. It was about marketing strategy for us. Now folks are coming to me, and we've hired, I wanna say 5 or 6 people from the private sector who are now working at the state. And if you're in the private sector, I'm coming for your employees. I'm honest about it, but we got some great opportunities, and that's something that we've been able to do as well.
That's great. Now, I just wanted to reaffirm the number that the state spends is $2.5 billion, right?
Billion.
Okay, billion, not million. Okay,
billion.
I just confirming
yes.
for everybody to know that what the spend is and what the opportunity is.
Yes.
You've all acknowledged that it's really important to have this commitment from the top and the importance of creating that culture up, down, and across the organization that not only displays their own bold leadership, but actually calls for that at every level within the organization. So this question goes to Unilever, to Mike and Mita. As a multinational organization, you're trying to set an example, you're leading the way, you've enacted that maternity leave policy you so proudly spoke about in the US, 16 weeks fully paid. Talk to us about where you've taken this next and what are the implications of that?
Yeah. Well, first thing I have to say this, and I'm sorry, Mita, to embarrass you, but you know exactly what I'm gonna say. There's a trend here. Mita led our Vaseline brand and was a lifelong marketeer as well. So only 1 year ago, so what I would say to you in the audience, would you ever think that she wasn't actually a lifelong D&I person? So really interesting of a couple of the trends here. So I wanted to just acknowledge that. Yeah, look, I think a couple of things I would say here. And, you know, I first want to, with not trying to sound provocative, but unfortunately it's in my blood, so bear with me. I actually don't think the conversations about government or big companies or small companies, I think we're moving to a place where it's about companies that get it and companies that don't, you know? And we have choices as consumers to partner with, buy media spend, do our banking with, you know, shop at Target, definitely buy Unilever products, with companies that get it. You know, and if you want to make a small difference, you can start to act with our wallets and act with our voices. So it's just an important point I want to get across. And I think this is something for us that is in our value system. And it's exactly why last Friday, we announced globally that we were going to move to 16 weeks around the world, no matter, and we operate in every country around the world, minimum of 16 weeks paid vacation. I'm sorry, paid maternity leave. Sorry. I don't want this to end up in the news, right? Scratch that. But, you know, our chief HR officer couldn't have been clearer in the fact that this is just a value of the company, that over 50% of the world's countries are below 16 weeks paid time off for women having children. So we just went to that globally around the world. I think we're probably the first multinational to set that around the world. And I think the question for us is, how do we play and leverage this fact that it's in our values, it's in our culture, but we're also trying to be influential and a bit disruptive and set the tone for what companies can do and create this coalition of companies that just get it. So I think for us, just watch, we want to be known in this space because it's core to what we do, because we actually want to help consumers live better lives every day.
And if I can kind of jump in on that, to look at that from the small company perspective, and because I agree with you, it's companies that get it and companies that don't, and there's a lot of conversation about values and so much of this being about being brave as an organization to live your values. So there was two quick points I wanted to make. One is, so for us as a small company, I can't right now afford to give 16 weeks paid maternity to all of our employees. But there are ways for us to take that value and express that in other ways. So one of the things that we implemented 8 years ago was a Babies at Work program. And it's for all parents, mothers and fathers, and it allows for parents who have just had a baby to have that baby in the workplace for up to 6 months or when the baby becomes mobile. Like, as soon as they start moving, they're out of there. They graduate. But I was actually the beta tester of this policy 8 years ago with my son, and what it allowed me to do was, after my 12-week maternity leave, I was able to bring him to work with me. I started with 3 days a week for a couple weeks, then I went down to 2 days a week, then I went down to 1 day a week, and it allowed both he and I to transition out of maternity leave back into full-time work. And I'm happy to say we've had both mothers and fathers participate in this program, and so that's been a way for us to offer something that expresses that value in a way that is sustainable for us as a smaller organization. And importantly, we also considered in that policy and in how we execute it, what does this look like and feel like for people who aren't parents, who actually don't want to be around a baby? Like, how does that work? And so that's part of the policy too, because that's real, right? Like, yeah, get this baby out of here. but I mean, that's a real thing, right? Like, each of us does not want to be forced to deal with like other people's stuff all the time. And so how can we create a policy that makes the workplace friendly for parents, but not unfriendly to non-parents? And I think that's really important, because certainly in my younger years, I worked at places where I felt like there were policies in place for parents, and the expectation for me as a non-parent was like, oh, you don't have kids, you can stay late, right? And we didn't want to have that culture. We wanted a culture that was about equity, no matter what the circumstance. The only other quick point I wanted to make about, you know, sort of the repercussions of being a bold leader and this idea of values is that the purpose of values on the positive side of things is to attract the customers, the employees, like all of the like-minded people, and that's great and wonderful. The downside of it that a lot of people don't think about and embrace as much is that really strong values should also repel some people. And that's very scary. So when you think about the repercussions, and you know, when Nancy talks about us coming out with a strong stance on Black Lives Matter, the bravery and risk in that was, this will repel some people. Maybe even some people that pay us money, and we have to have the bravery to say, this is who we are, and if they are repelled by that value of ours, then those aren't people that we want to work with. But that is a very scary decision to make, as any size company, to say, I am willing to alienate some number of people to stand up for this is who we are.
And I have to tell you that your point is so well made, and it's in this particular case, it's almost easier to do that in a smaller setting than it is in a larger company. And mm-hmm. the example I will use is of Jennie Rometty at IBM, if you remember the backlash that she faced when she decided that IBM was going to take a seat at the table with President Trump's administration when they convened this Council of Business Leaders. And she faced a tremendous backlash from IBM employees who said, you know, we don't think IBM should actually stand up and be a part of it. So the risk, in my opinion, is further magnified. This is going to be our last question before we go to Q&A, so I hope that all of you are sending your questions in. But this question goes to Jennie. You have a shift in leadership coming. You have a new CEO that's going to be coming on board. How are you going to keep up with this momentum? You've got this new leading with your heart that, you know, every time I talk to Greg, it's reaffirmed for me that this work is as much about the heart as it is about the head. And so how are you going to maintain that momentum at U.S. Bank?
That is a great question. And many of you in Minnesota know Richard Davis, our outgoing CEO, is all heart. And Andy Cesari, our incoming CEO, is very, very head. We call them Kirk and Spock. Together, they make a normal person. Neither one should be allowed out alone. I may not be here next year. But that's important. And what we have to say is, Andy leads our women's BRG groups. He is the executive sponsor of our women's BRG groups. And he has learned and at the feet of the master, basically, with Richard. But we have to go with what he is. And we have to balance that. We've tried to make the heart part of our DNA and part of our core values. But we'll have other people who don't necessarily have to be the CEO, maybe the CFO, Terry Dolan, maybe our chief strategy officer, Kate Quinn, maybe someone else in the leadership team or that we bring into the leadership team, but we always need that balance. The values are the same. How you express them may be different, but it's important to have the values. And I just want to say before we end that we not only need to change the culture of the whole organization, we need to change the jobs at the top because we have great tools, great technology, and we still are looking at people at the top who want to come in early in the morning, stay late at night, and you know, see a 7:30 Monday morning meeting as a good thing and not you know a pain in the neck. So we've got to change the jobs, and if we do that, we'll have more women and people of color at the top. The bank is 62% women. We have 4 of 14 on our managing committee. So we've come a long way. We've got a long way to go, and if you told me when I started my career in 1985 that we would be at this level that now, I would have run screaming from the room.
Thank you.
I just want to add to that because Jennie raises a good point about our incoming CEO who, you know, is very much, you know, he leads with the data, right, which is fine. And so I think how he sort of gets to the answer or to the conclusion or behavior that we want will be very different. But I think he will get to the same place just differently. Because when I think about certainly who he is, you know, this is a person who grew up in, you know, Cabrini Green and in Chicago and was the first to even finish high school in his family. And so from that perspective, I think he, you know, he certainly leads with empathy, but in his own way. And I loved your point about, you know, it certainly you got to have that leadership from the top. But once the culture starts to take over and you sort of, you know, share the accountability and you share the responsibility, that it's not about a single person.
Right.
It's it made me think about something else I said. I know we're like at 10 seconds here, but well, I'll let you get to the question because I'll just keep going. So go ahead.
That's all right. Finish
Maybe the there'll be a question that allows me. Well, I wanted to talk about, because this thing came up and it keeps coming up throughout the week, as we talk about millennials. And I firmly believe, like, millennial is not just a demographic, it's a mindset.
Yes.
And I think so much of what's going to change our culture, millennials are going to change the culture just because of who they are. And so how do we as leaders continue to prepare them to step into these leadership roles? Because I'm about to piss off all the baby boomers in the room, because I feel like we, and I'm putting myself in that bucket, that, you know, many times with the barrier to progress is ourselves. And I think we're baby boomers, we're so afraid of these millennials and that they're not ready to take over and they're not ready to sort of lead. Maybe they are, maybe they aren't. But the sort of the perspective that they bring to our companies, our communities, is really refreshing. And, you know, I hear many, you know, many people talk about, well, I'm not on Twitter and I'm not on, well, guess what? That's where the conversation is happening. Like, our last two presidents, you know, mastered the art of social media, and in many ways is largely responsible for how they sort of got to where they are. And so whether you disagree or agree with their point of view, it's sort of thinking about these new ways of communicating and connecting, and how they're sort of demanding a different, you know, cultural expectation from us as they enter our organizations and enter these leadership roles.
Well, you know what? I'm always amused when I hear these sort of generalization about millennials. And I say to my baby boomer friends and colleagues, remember, for those of us that chose to have children, we raised these millennials. They sat at our dining tables and we made them feel important. We asked their opinion for everything, starting from what do you want to eat tonight to where do you want to go on vacation. Why do you think that would change when they come into the workplace? And then when they played on teams, irrespective of how good they always got a trophy. Remember? So we created them. So now they're in the workplace and they're asking for all of those same things of us. Right? So, I think we have time for questions.
Actually, I hate to be the bad person yet. Oh, I've got a theme going here.
Could we have one question?
We actually have only 15 minutes to our next session.
Okay, oh
so
my God.
I need to have you all thank Subha and the governor and our wonderful panel.
Thank you.
I don't like this theme that I'm coming up with, being the guy with the hook. They were telling me I was like Van Jones's hook guy. That's not good. So I do want to thank our panel and Subha, and I also want to have a special thanks, of course, to Thrivent and Bill McKinney for sponsoring this morning's general session and helping us bring all these folks together. I have a special shout out also to folks from the Itasca Group. Itasca, for those of you who don't know who are not local, is a local cohort of CEO folks who come together quite often, partnering with us at the forum. And they had a breakfast this morning and have joined us for this session as well. So we're very happy to have them. A quick reminder that it is just 15 minutes until your next session, but also to visit exhibitors as you can. And we'll see you back here at lunch for our closing presentation and our awards ceremony. Thanks, everyone, and have a great morning. Mm-hmm.